All right, we'll go ahead and start tonight. So we have really two more classes left in this Christian Doctrine 1 course. And so tonight, then next Wednesday, then we'll have several weeks off as far as the Institute goes. We'll still be praying together. We have one night that we do some caroling in our community, which will be cool. We'll start the next course sometime in 2022. But we have two more left, or we'll finish this out, kind of this course out with the work of Christ, part one tonight, and then the work of Christ, part two, next Wednesday. I hope that you've found these classes helpful to you. Maybe stretching to you, but that's a good thing, right? The goal here is to give us at least some kind of good foundation on which to continue by God's grace and through His Spirit to keep building on for the rest of our lives. And so the goal was not to come out of this an expert in all things, but to at least have some building blocks in place that we can keep building on as we go, some wells that might be a little bit deeper that we can keep drawing water from as we go. So hopefully you found that to be the case. And so if you feel like at times you've been maybe drinking from a fire hydrant, or just barely catching little bits and pieces along the way, great. Drink as fast as you can drink and catch all the portions that you can catch. And then have fun continuing to build on that as you go. And with hopefully, you know, with the end that we would be growing in our affection for Jesus, right? We want to our theology here to lead us to doxology, that we would worship Christ the King. As we see more of who he is. Maybe you also, you've been here and this has been kind of old hat to you. So if that's the case, hopefully it's been at least a refresher and kind of refreshing to hear some of what you already knew and just be kind of reaffirmed in your love and knowledge of Jesus. And so wherever you're at, hopefully it's been fruitful in those kind of ways. My goal tonight is to kind of give us some of the biblical language and categories for understanding the work of Christ. And then next time to walk through, again, like a second pass, but maybe organized in a different way. And so we'll have some biblical categories as we look at Christ's office, this threefold office of prophet, priest, and king tonight. And then next week we're going to try to cover, I like laugh even saying it, we're going to try to cover the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Christ in one night. So let's pray because we need help to do those things. So let's pray. God, we're grateful for just another opportunity to gather together as the body of Christ to encourage one another in the faith, to hear from your word. God, I pray that this would be fruitful to us tonight, that as we look and behold Jesus in this text, that we would grow in our affection for him. God, that our theology tonight would not simply land in our minds, but it would shape our hearts. So may we be worshipers of Christ as we look and think on, read and see all that he has done. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so last week, I wasn't able to be here, but Spencer finished up part two of the person of Christ. And it's right and it's good that we first look at the person of Christ before we get to the work of Christ, because the two things are dependent on each other. What Jesus does is directly connected to who he is. And just like Jesus is unique in his person, his work, we're going to also see, is unique. So there is none like Jesus, and there is none that has accomplished what he has accomplished. And so he's unique in his person and also his work, and his person and his work go together, necessarily so. So the two are connected, and the order is important. His work flows from his person. We need it done for us what only a God-man could do for us. And so Jesus is unique, like I said, both in his person then, as we saw the last couple of weeks, and we'll also see he is unique in his work, and the two go together. So we need to, along with establishing the uniqueness of his person, like Spencer did, we need to also then establish, and we're going to start to do that tonight, the uniqueness of his work. I think especially in a like pluralistic society that seeks to relativize or marginalize or diminish in some capacity both the person and the work of Jesus, we as Christians want to be clear that he's unique in both his person and his work, that he alone saves, that he's unlike any other, and his work is singular in that way. It's unique. It's unlike any other work, for he is unlike any other person. No other person or angel or prophet or created being in any kind of way would be able to do to accomplish what Christ has done, what Christ has accomplished. Now, with that being said, there's often in theology a connection made from what others have done and what Christ would do and has done and is continuing to do, though Christ's work is utterly and unique, but the work of man in the past foreshadows what he was going to do and even continues to do. And so we'll tease that out a little bit here in a minute. So theologians often speak, and I mentioned this earlier, of the work of Christ with the idea of this threefold office. And the idea is to try to find a way to put hands, kind of, on all that Christ has done. And that's not a small task, right? I mean, think about the magnitude of the topic at hand. If we just put on our paper the work of Christ, like maybe you're taking notes and you wrote that down, not super hard to put on there, but think about the magnitude of what you just wrote. The work of Christ, the redemptive, cosmic, salvific, glorious, multifaceted, perfect, to which all of history was pointing and from which all of eternity will look back on, work of Christ. Put that on the title of your notes. That's what we have. That's the work. The work foreshadowed in the Old Testament all the way from its very first pages, foretold in the prophets, described for us in the Gospels, explained to us in the epistles, and fully realized in the last days. This grand work in two short classes, kind of mind-boggling. So, theologians have often, throughout history, spoken of the threefold office of Christ as a way to describe them, to put some handles on the work of Christ. They speak of the work of Christ in regards to his office. Now, I said threefold office, right? Not office.